Hey guys, welcome back to the channel. This is part 4 of Naruto, the ultimate deterrent weapon. If you guys enjoyed this what if, and want to see part 5 of it, comment down below and let me know. The like goal for this video is 150 likes. So like this video, to let me know that you're interested in this series, and you want the next part. And go ahead, and check out other what ifs in the channel. Before we start, please do support for more awesome content. Don't forget to subscribe and leave a like, and also share this video with your friends. So let's start this video. So, you have a goal, but is there any other reason? Do you not have anyone precious to you? I think for one to truly be strong, they should fight for the one that is most precious to them. Well, I don't think that is the only way to get strong. Looked over at Kuromi and smiled to himself. But I would say I do have at least one person important to me. Well, anyone. He stood and dusted himself off. Well, nice talking to you, Haku-chan. Tell Zabuza that waiting. This put her on edge as she fingered the small needles. He started walking out of the clearly as it took a bit Haku to get what was said. Naruto whistled through the forest as he walked away. It didn't take him longer than a minute before he spoke out. Stop. A sharp needle stopped against his neck, which was held by Haku behind him. But he wasn't talking to her. He was talking to Kuromi, who, while still in her larger fox form, had her jaws open behind Haku's neck, causing the girl to shiver nervously. Naruto turned around, not at all bothered by the needle, and looked at her bored. Not very smart to attack me. I'm pretty sure I did nothing wrong. You know of my connection to Zabuza, and that he is still alive. So, you pose a threat that I must eliminate for my master. Naruto motioned with his hand and Kuromi backed off from Haku and trotted to his side, but kept an eye on the girl. My entire team knows Zabuza is still alive, and that you are likely his ally. Though I'm the only one who knows your actual identity, but that's because of my senses. I'm letting you go to give Zabuza a heads up to be ready, but also because I prefer to give women a chance. She slowly lowered her weapon, but kept a trained eye on him and the fox. Don't assume my gender, I'm male. Come on now, that shit again. He sighed and glanced over at Kuromi, who looked away for a second, before he focused back on Haku. I'm sure there are all kinds of reasons to lie about your gender, but I can't be tricked. You smell like a woman, though that's not always a 100% proof to go by. But I also have a sense where I can feel every curve of your body and I can tell, you're female. She blushed and tried to cover herself with her arms. I didn't do anything perverted. She decided that for simplicity, it would be best to believe him. Fine, I will trust you, and tell Zabuza that you are expecting him. So next time, I'm sorry to say we will meet as enemies. She formed a hand seal and vanished in a swirl of mist. Naruto spun on his heel and walked away from the clearing with Kuromi. Just because I didn't kill you, don't think that means we weren't already enemies. I tell you boy, your help means the world to me. Tazuna said to Naruto as the boy carried beams of wood across the bridge. Tazuna was short on workers, and so the bridge building was taking longer than usual. Naruto volunteered to help, which Tazuna initially refused, saying that Naruto and his team was already doing enough for them. So Naruto pretty much forced his way into helping. The boy was strong enough to lift wooden beams that would take 2 to 4 grown men some work to lift, and he did it tirelessly. When Tazuna asked him why Naruto was doing this for him, the boy simply responded. Sometimes you have to show people you're strong, especially when they think you aren't. Because when you show you're strong, you don't get pushed around. That response wasn't his answer, but him giving advice to Tazuna for Gato. Naruto's words and actions served to inspire the remaining workers to stay, and some over the week's time to even come back. To the wave civilians' amazement, Naruto even used shadow clones to speed up the production. He only made around 10, but with Naruto's stamina and strength, all the workers had to do was the carpentering and the aesthetics, which made the job way easier for them and faster. Tazuna didn't want to take the young shinobi away from his training, but stopped complaining when Naruto said all the work he was doing was working his muscles, so it helped him anyway. Or at least that's what he said. Really, it was just to keep Naruto's hands busy. The entire time he was also controlling his chakra discreetly. The seal is degrading nervously fast. Naruto rubbed his chin as he looked at the seal on Kuromi's cage in his mindscape. Is that bad? Kuromi wondered as she laid down in the grass away from him. For you it's not at the way it is now, you can probably use half your chakra. That's girly fast. My chakra's natural properties is breaking down the seal. Well, you will be free like I promised, the seal might be decreasing faster than my body can adjust to. Sorry that it's causing you trouble. They don't worry about it, I'll figure something out, but you are getting out of here soon regardless, don't worry. She turned over to look at his back and smiled softly. You'd better keep your promise. But I'd rather you not kill yourself in the process of fulfilling said promise. Say Kuromi. Kuriya perked up at him in attention. How are the other Biju's relationships with their containers? I'm not completely sure since I've been sealed for a lot of the time since Jinchuriki were known. From what I've gathered since waking up, and you other Biju for the most part have either an indifferent or angered relationship with their containers. There are a few that are more friendly with their containers. The Hachibi and its host being a prime example. Why? just wondering what I should expect is all. I would imagine not other Jinchuriki have the relationship we have. Our situation is definitely not a common one. Though I would be careful if you do happen to meet another container. Why is that? Well, simply because you are my host, you are automatically placed at the peak of the hierarchy. You outrank other Jinchuriki, which is to be expected since you're mine. Naruto snorted, causing Kuromi to blush as she corrected herself. My container. But that might also cause a few of the other Biju to be at odds with you. There is also the likely chance that other Jinchuriki can use their Biju's power to some degree. Well, that's good to know. Still, it would be cool to meet others like me. Naruto then went into silence as he continued to inspect the seal in her presence. She sat up and watched him for a few minutes. It would be hard for her to saw it, but she really did enjoy being around him. In only a month and a half's time, her life had turned around completely, and she for once had someone outside her siblings that she could say she had some kind of bond with. The feelings she felt, though she wasn't sure what all they were, or rather didn't want to acknowledge the state of them. She fidgeted a little, before letting out a breath and biting her lip. Naru, container. Naruto turned to look at her, curious at being called. Yakuromi-chan. There he goes with the familiar addressing with her. Yet she allowed it for some reason. Well, if you want, you can use my power. You know, when you are in trouble. It would be inconvenient for me if you were to die too soon after all. Nah, I'm alright. What? She went blank for a second before getting a little irritated. Do you know what an honor it is for me to allow you to? I didn't mean to hurt your feelings, Kuromi-chan. I just never planned on using anyone's power other than my own. I grew up with my own power, I survived through my own power. The only time I would say I use your power was when the seal kept me from dying as a child. At least I think it was the seal. Her mood instantly dropped, as was the trend whenever he mentioned the harshness of his childhood. He saw her ears droop and smiled as he turned to her. If you wanna fight with me, though, I guess I can use your power with the exception that you use me as well. Is that okay? She smirked and tilted her head up away from him. HMPH, as if I would ever need anything from you. But okay, I accept those conditions. Naruto chuckled at her act. Cute as always. He leaned in and gave her a quick kiss on the cheek before she could react, and left the mindscape vanishing as she blushed shyly. As she sat there in the grass by there, her hand subconsciously went to the thick chain around her neck. I am not cute, I'm an intimidating force of nature, Baka. She mumbled to herself. No, you're not. She jumped when Naruto's voice echoed through the mindscape, showing that while he left, he was still connected to it. Will you go away? She growled as she could hear the fading of Naruto's chuckling in the sky. Naruto woke up in his bed and stretched. He had a few bandages on his arms, and scattered lightly over the rest of his body from the damage his training had caused. Wasn't that big of a deal to him though. His ear twitched when he heard the sound of metal cutting through wood, accompanied by a womanly scream and dishes breaking. Naruto felt into his sensory skill and was able to feel the presence of intruders in the house, along with the fact that his team was not in the house. Best they left guard duty to me. Well, at least they let me sleep. He sat up and pulled the bandages from his body as he had healed up overnight on his own. He grinned excitedly as his hair flared out slightly from his intent. Showtime. There were two men who could be assumed to be bandits holding swords. The shorter of the two had a malicious smirk on his face as they dragged Tsunami out. Yeah, it sucks being the bridge builder's daughter, but you're coming with us now. Ka-chan. Tsunami's eyes widened in fear as Inari came out, gaining the sword wielder's attentions. Oh, look, the brat came out for his mommy, hahaha. Leave my mother alone. The taller of the bandits grinned as he approached Inari, unsheathing his sword. Oh, so the snot-nosed kid thinks he can order us around, does he? Don't touch him. I'll do whatever you want, just please don't harm my child. They looked back and saw the defiance in Tsunami's eyes and laughed as they left the boy. We are definitely going to hold you to that when we get you to Gato. They took her away as Inari watched, crying. His legs shook, but he was unable to move. The images of his father and Naruto flashed in his head. He didn't want to lose anyone else. He didn't want to always suffer. There were others who suffered more than him but kept going. He may be weak, but he can make himself stronger. And it was with that thought that Inari grabbed a kitchen knife and ran at them, screaming. Let go of her. Inari, stop. The young mother's eyes were wide in horror as the swordsman turned on Inari, and she could do nothing about it. Looks like the kid decided he didn't want to live anymore. The big one swung his sword down at Inari as the boy stabbed at him. The blade cuts through the air fast to hit Inari before the kitchen knife could even touch him. There was a gust of wind and took a few seconds for the people there to realize what happened as a voice spoke out. Oh, not bad, Inari. Though if you are fighting someone, I wouldn't scream out like that unless you can move faster than sound. You want to talk. Very funny, Kuromi. He mentally spoke out to his fox dryly. Everyone looked on shock as Naruto was standing there between them, holding Inari's wrist with one hand and catching the bandit sword between his curled index and middle finger of his other hand. Who are you? Naruto looked at the shorter man holding Tsunami boredly. The baddest. Who are you? I'm a kitchen knife was suddenly stabbing the man through the shoulder, causing him to release her. Unimportant. Inari looked down at his hands, seeing the knife gone. The taller bandit looked at him with some fear now. What did you do?
No one yet. Maybe a hot fox girl at some point. After that, who knows?
Naruto nodded his head to himself and looked off into space. His seal burned for a second, but he ignored it.
What?
The man was confused as hell now.
You know you should really get a better sword.
Huh? What's wrong with the one I'm using? A shock went through Naruto's arm, and he twisted his wrist, shattering the sword into fragments away from him.
It's shit.
The metal shard stabbed into the man's chest and face, and he fell back bleeding out. The shorter man started to scramble back for his life as he held his impaled shoulder. Naruto moved to Tsunami and untied her. The moment she was free, she clung onto his shirt, hugging him as she frantically spouted out a series of thank yous. Naruto just rubbed her back as he looked down at her son.
Good job, Inari.
It is because of you stalling them that your mother is still here. Who knows what would have happened if they got away. Speaking of which, Naruto looked where the other bandit was running. He blurred out of sight, and before he knew it, the man was being held up with one hand around his throat as he wet himself. Naruto got an insane gleam in his eye as he leered at the man.
Now, you are going to answer some questions for me.
This was the wrong time to let Naruto rest. Kakashi regretted as he held Zabuza's sword off with a kunai. When they got to the bridge, Zabuza and his accomplice attacked them.
It's a shame, really. I wanted to fight that kid again.
That other black-haired brat seems to have gotten stronger, since he was able to take care of my water clone so easily, but he is still no match for Haku. And let's face it, the pink girl is useless. Zabuza cackled as he swung his sword at Kakashi again. Zabuza was no joke, as he wasn't playing around like before. Zabuza had planned this out as well. His miss wasn't just used for silent killing, but also to reduce the visibility of Kakashi's Sharingan, making this much hard. Sasuke's own kunai met a senbon as he fended off the hunter.
You should really give up.
Since you are Naruto-kun's friend, I wouldn't want to kill you. Sasuke's eyes widened in confusion for a second before it went away.
You know, Naruto.
Wait, it doesn't matter, I'm not his friend, and you should be the one giving up.
You won't win.
I see. Well, no hard feelings then. Haku brought up one hand, shocking Sasuke as she made hand seals. You can make a jutsu that way. Haku ended on a seal and 1,000 needles materialized from the water in the air. All the needles rained down on Sasuke. He smirked, and a second later he vanished from the spot the needles stabbed down on to appear in the air. Sasuke threw several kunai, forcing Haku to jump back. Haku suddenly leaned to the side, and a kunai went by from behind her. She looked back to see Sakura smirking at her. She realized too late that it was meant to distract and not hit, as a moment later Sasuke impacted his knee on the face of her mask. The blow sent her tumbling back.
Looks like my chakra is working well.
Zabuza's eyes widened as Haku was actually forced back, causing Kakashi to chuckle. Seems you underestimated my genin. Kids tend to love to prove the adults wrong. Sasuke is one of our village's most promising young fights, and he's an Uchiha. Sakura, well, not much right now, is incredibly book smart and a natural tactician. So her offensive power is weak, but she still knows how to be an excellent diversion. An Uchiha, I thought they were wiped out. Sasuke is the last one we have left. Not only an Uzumaki, but now an Uchiha. Haku, don't play around anymore.
Yes, Zabuza.
Haku stood up unharmed and made a lone hand seal. She unleashed her chakra as the air around her noticeably chilled. Sasuke looked on anxiously as the air frosted.
What is this?
Sasuke was surrounded by floating mirrors made of ice. To their amazement, Haku made contact with one of the mirrors and sunk into it. He shivered as he could see his breath from how low the air temperature dropped.
This is my bloodline.
You think you're fast? I'll show you speed. The moment Haku finished her part, Sasuke flinched as a cut appeared on his cheek.
What was that?
I said it was speed. This jutsu lets me move at near the speed of light. The voice echoed around him, before he felt pain from all sides as he was cut up.
Sasuke!
Kakashi shouted and ran to help him, only to be blocked off by Zabuza.
Not so fast, Kakashi.
Go for Haku and I take out the bridge builder and that pink chihuahua of a student you have. Kakashi glared but forced himself to leave Sasuke and hope he could handle himself as he dealt with Zabuza. After a few minutes, Kakashi was not able to push the advantage. He was out of shape and practice from what he used to be. He knew that now, and that could cost him, especially since Zabuza hadn't been as injured by their first battle as he had been. Zabuza planned against his Sharingan and it worked well, and yet Kakashi had neither a plan nor the reserves to counter him. Zabuza laughed out at Kakashi as he started to sweat.
Hehoho, that boy is probably down on his luck by now, Kakashi, and pretty soon you will be next.
It's a shame, really. I was hoping for that other kid to be here, but I'll find him after I drop your body in the sea.
Someone call me. Both veteran shinobi's eyes widened at the shout.
Sasuke's knees were weak as he was bleeding quite a bit. None of his wounds were that deep, but the pain and blood loss would get to him soon, and the lower temperature was already draining his stamina. He was able to see the blurring paths of Haku's movements, but not much else, and so was not able to really stop her.
You have good eyes if you are even able to notice me, but I'm afraid I'll have to end this here. Don't stop yet, the main act has just arrived. Haku looked up from her place in the mirror at the voice, surprised. They heard the pelting of footsteps, and a second later Haku cried out as she was knocked out of her mirror as a knee strike from behind shattered it in a burst of static. Ku. Everyone's eyes widened, even Sakura and Tazuna's, as Naruto dropped down into the dome of mirrors, as broken ice fell down around him sparkling, and he posed with a finger to the sky. The ultimate weapon is here. Kuromi giggled in his head. You love Theatrix. Naruto relaxed his posture and looked over at Sasuke, who was almost on the ground. Wow, you look like shit. Sasuke glared as he momentarily forgot his injuries. Now isn't the time, idiot. This ninja has some strange bloodline that lets her use ice and merge with it moving at high speeds. Naruto shrugged boredly. You're saying it like it's that big of a deal, and I haven't already figured most of that out, since most of that is currently present right now. I'm assuming if you are crying about it, then your fire jutsu isn't working on the ice. It hardly does anything, and the damage it does do, she quickly repairs it. Naruto looked over at the mirror he broke only to see it suddenly reform itself. He glanced to the side as Haku got up quickly and flipped back into a mirror. Hey Haku-chan, we meet again. Naruto-kun, it's nice to see you. I don't suppose I can convince you to not fight. If you guys back off, we won't kill you. Sorry, but we have a job. Even if Gato is a terrible person, we must complete our task, unless Abusa-sama decides otherwise. That being said, I don't think you are in a case to kill anyone. Naruto's eye fluttered for a second as a cut appeared on his cheek. He stared at Haku another second before rubbing his cheek with his thumb, showing the cut gone. What was that, Sasuke? It's another part of her jutsu. She said it lets her move at light speed. Light speed, huh? Well then Sasuke, you're at my back. Sasuke stood up and had his back to Naruto's. Now form fire jutsu, I have a plan. Sasuke sucked his teeth but listened as he formed hand seals. The moment he did, there were blurs all around him as Haku grabbed his hand. Sasuke's eyes dilated as Haku pulled back a handful of ice sandbone. She felt killing intent and saw Naruto move over Sasuke with his legs swinging and a blank look in his eyes. She slid back and flipped away as Naruto's foot hit the ground in front of Sasuke, where Haku was cutting into it with a low boom. She panted as a second later her mask fell away, split down the middle. Naruto ran a hand through his hair and laughed out loud. I said I had a plan where you could hear it. Did you think I was stupid? I knew you would likely try to stop Sasuke from doing what I said somehow, as that was the only clear information you had to act on. Now then. Naruto moved to Sasuke and pulled a few senbon out of his back, making Sasuke yelp out. You said she could move at light speed. Well, it's good news to know that isn't true, or we would both be screwed. You could see her, couldn't you? I could see all of it this time. Naruto rose an eyebrow and whistled when he saw his eyes. Well, looks like the last Uchiha got his eyes. Sasuke's eyes widened upon hearing that as he grew excited. My Sharingan. I'm a true Uchiha now. I can't be stopped. Naruto blinked as Sasuke fell to the ground unconscious. Well, that's just disappointing. Guess he suffered shock from the cold and the sudden surprise drain from activating his Sharingan. Well, it's just you and me now, Haku. Haku's sweat dropped when Naruto carelessly kicked Sasuke's prone form out of the dome. Haku ignored it and held up a fist full of senbons. Please reconsider, I would dislike killing you. You're underestimating me if you think I can. Haku sighed and narrowed her eyes at his response. So be it. A body moving at extreme speed zipped past Naruto, and a series of cuts appeared on his forearm. Naruto didn't even budge. She went in and out of a mirror before doing the same thing, and repeated as she became a series of streaks around Naruto. Cuts and slashes appeared over Naruto and his clothes as he stood there unflinching. Tell me, Haku. What? His lack of concern and reaction to her attacks unnerved her. Why do you follow Zabuza so much? You're your own person, so you shouldn't throw your life away that easily. Zabuza saved me from my own loneliness and a lonely death. Lonely? Naruto's eyes shifted around as Haku dashed around him. Yes, you see, in the lands of water around the Mist Village, there has been a purging of those with bloodlines, led by the Mizukage. Anyone with bloodlines were seen as demons who didn't have a right to live. Naruto flinched at that. Haku noticed, but continued. One day shortly, after awakening my bloodline, my father saw me practicing with it. He gathered a mob and set out to kill me and my mother. While he did kill my mother, I managed to kill them all and escape. As I ran from town to town alone looking for scraps as the civil war of the country had rendered local towns to poverty, I was found by Zabuza. He took me in, trained me, and gave me purpose. Even if it's simply to be his weapon, I will fulfill my duty and debt to him. Haku, you don't know how much I can relate to you. Haku stopped in her assault as she stood half out of one mirror listening to him. But your life is your own. I understand you feeling you owe Zabuza, but at this point don't throw your life away. If you have no reason to live without Zabuza, then find another reason. You said one becomes strong when they have someone to protect. Well, someone who is trying to protect someone and doesn't have any goals is just wasting their time. Sorry Naruto-kun, but I can't stop. I'm not doing this just because I am fulfilling my obligation to Zabuza. I am doing this because I want to help him. Naruto smiled at her. Guess I was wrong. But if you hope to kill me, you're gonna need something bigger than needles. That wouldn't be hard to do. The ice needles in her hand drew in moisture and stretched into small swords. She dashed straight at aimed for his head. I wished we could have become friends. Please don't hate me in the next life. Naruto gave a summer smile as Haku dashed around him progressively closer. I definitely know what it's like to be alone, and I can definitely see us being close. To abuse it as your reason for being strong. Well then you said that it is only when you have someone precious to you to protect that you can be strong. Well then Haku, what if someone who is already strong finds someone precious to them? The one precious to me neither you nor Zabuza can compare to. Haku zipped behind Naruto with her ice blades held to run through his back. She felt a dark glare on her, and she froze as a chill went along her back as she backed off quickly. She panted slightly as she looked at Naruto warily. This feeling of unease. She tried her luck again and dashed at Naruto from this side. The moment she got close again the dark presence actually warped her vision as she saw Naruto. His eye gleamed as his face was shadowed, and luck with her own the moment, she got close as a glowing slitted eye bore into her. She felt like an ant approaching a titan for a split second. He can follow me at this speed. You have incredible tracking, if you are still able to follow me at this speed. Yeah, I have great eyes, but I rely on a sixth sense I have that lets me feel movement around me. You said you move at the speed of light. You are hardly moving at a fraction of the speed of sound, you just have great stealth. He mentally gained a nervous smile however as he thought. Not gonna lie though, the instant she leaves one of the mirrors her speed is much faster than I can track, but she slows down greatly after. She is probably limited by how fast she can react when she is traveling at that speed, and so slows down. So your sensors as well. He shrugged. I guess so. Well it won't matter if you can sense me if you can't move fast enough to stop me. She jumped back and forth speeding up causing Naruto to smirk. It's thanks to those mirrors, that you are indeed faster than me. She shot straight forward at Naruto this time with her ice blade wielding hand pointed out at his head. I'm sorry that I have to end it like this. You're faster, but I'm pretty fast myself and with my abilities in chakra then, even if it's for a moment. She ran into Naruto and an instant later her weapons were shattered, and she flew back. Then I can counter even someone moving at your speed. The impact caused a shockwave to ring out that cracked the ice around them, and Haku was sent flying through her own ice mirror, shattering it as she tumbled across the bridge. He struck me too, number three times in that exchange, yet I didn't even see them. Kakashi whistled as Zabuza, who was stuck in an exchange with him, was shocked. Naruto chuckled through the mist as he walked towards Haku's lying body. The mirrors behind them started to fall apart. I have to say Ukeke Genkei is a thing of beauty, but with my bloodline, even if it didn't outrank yours, it also has the type advantage over you. So, you are gifted as well. Your bloodline is one I've never heard of before. She shakily got up on her feet as blood dripped from her mouth. As far as I know, I'm the only one with this specific bloodline. I used to think it was sound or shockwaves, but upon studying it, I found out what the root of my bloodline was, and through chakra control, I've made it better. It is simply the control of the movement of molecules and atoms. Vibrations, if you will. The flow of my chakra is erratic like the excited palpitations of an irregular heartbeat. He held his hands out as he moved towards Haku. His hands went out, and the air started to distort around them rhythmically as a dull beat went out. It excites my body like a heavy pulse. He dashed at Haku without warning, surprising those watching at his top speed. Naruto was very fast for his age, but for someone like Haku who was used to high speed, she was able to react. She jumped back and threw a handful of senbon at Naruto in waves. Without slowing down, he left short after images as he dodged the three waves of needles by inches. She gasped as Naruto was already on her. You're good, but you don't have the physical power to stop me. Pulsation release. Base. Naruto's palm gained a white translucent glow as it struck the mirror, but Haku was ready as she put more chakra into this specific mirror than the other ones. Naruto's palm shattered it all the same, and the shockwave traveled with pinpoint force as it hit her in her core, and she vomited a little blood and was sent tumbling. Naruto continued to walk towards her calmly as she struggled to get up. That was a great defensive use of your jutsu, but you don't have enough chakra to block me. Haku, we are on par in almost every category. The difference is I'm physically stronger, but that's not as important. My stamina, chakra levels far outmatch yours, and with the type advantage of my bloodline, you will lose this, so just give up. She gave a smile that unnerved Naruto a little as she started making hand seals. I'm sorry, but I can't do that. You are strong and I may very well die here, but I won't give up either. If you don't kill me, I'll end up only killing you. The chain broke out of the ground, and went around her neck choking her as she gagged, forcing her to drop her hand seals. The rest of the chain tore out of the ground, showing that it was a chakra chain coming out of Naruto's lower back. The chain pulled Haku towards Naruto within range. His eyes deadened as he looked right at her. I'm sorry. Naruto, without another thought, put his palm to Haku's cheek, and a pulse went through her body as she let out a silent scream before a torrent of blood sprayed out of her mouth. The light slowly left her eyes as they closed. Was I at least of use to Yuzabuza? Did my life mean anything? She only spoke the last part, but Naruto understood it all. As she died, he held her body and slowly laid her down on the ground. He could have killed her in more gruesome and less quick ways, but out of respect for her, he chose this method. It was a risk in the fact it was solely close range, but it exploded the enemy's heart and collapsed their lungs, by forcing a suddenly strong pulse through the body, blowing up the veins and arteries in the chest, as the air expanded outwards. Thank you for the great fight. Yet I still can't help but feel you were holding back against me even a little. Naruto, move. Naruto looked up away from Haku at the sound of Kakashi's frantic cry. He glanced behind him as he felt insane killing intent to see Zabuza spinning his giant sword above him with a demonic aura about him. It was thanks to Naruto's on instincts coupled with his sensory skills that he was able to sense Zabuza's actions. Naruto turned around as Zabuza brought the momentum of the blade down diagonally at Naruto. Naruto instinctive attacked, moving his arms at the same frenzied speed as when they met Haku. The clash issued for a second before a result was made. Blood flew as a cut opened up on Naruto from his shoulder to his hip as arms moved fast enough to break the sword's blade up on contact with the impact of his chakra strikes. It didn't stop him from getting sliced though. Naruto winced as some of the metal shards from the blade had broken off in his body, making it harder for his wound to heal. Haku did her job, but you will pay for what you did. Naruto jumped back as Kakashi came to his aid, and smirked with a slight grimace as he held his wound. So you did care for Haku. It makes me feel better knowing she didn't completely waste her life. Come on Kakashi, I was expecting you to take care of him. Kakashi had the decency to look embarrassed as Naruto stood up straight on his own. Sorry, Naruto. He fights too well in this mist, so he got away from me. How are you doing though? Both with your kill and injury. Naruto scoffed morbidly at the question. With the kind of childhood I've had, if that was my first kill, I would either have to be dead or retarded. As for the injury, well, I've had worse. Naruto locked eyes with Zabuza, seeing the man was angry at him, which wasn't surprising. Naruto only smiled at that which angered the man more. You have my respects, Zabuza, but you are on your last legs. Kakashi may not have been able to finish you off, but you weren't going to last much longer, were you? It doesn't matter what state my body is in. To go out fighting fits someone like me. I can understand, but it's a shame really. The way you are now, I bet even a Genin with some skill can beat you. Naruto sweated lightly as that caused Zabuza's intent to spike and the demonic aura behind him to take shape. Naruto, what are you doing? Naruto raised up a hand to stop Kakashi as Zabuza held his sword out at Naruto. At a quick speed, where he vanished, Zabuza made his way towards Naruto. Naruto, however, made a simple ram sign with one hand as he calmed his breathing. A split second later, Naruto recoiled as Zabuza appeared before him and struck him with his sword. It hit Naruto's neck with a clang. The blade hit the chain around Naruto's neck, protecting him, though he still felt the impact as Naruto couldn't breathe. He wheezed but didn't fall as he brought back up his hand sign. You're like a raging bull right now. If I threw myself in harm's way, you come running. Naruto's chakra became visible before it became sparks, and he pulsed it outward like a wave. Zabuza's body seized up as half his body was paralyzed on the side holding the sword. The four swordsmen could back up a giant chain stabbed him through his chest. You damn Uzumaki. Naruto grinned before his slitted eyes dilated, and he felt a wave of dizziness and pain. Naruto vaguely registered the screams in his head and around him. He vaguely knew who the screams belonged to, but that wasn't what his mind was on. His mind was handling the paint of metal fragments erupting out of his body wound, draining and feeding on his blood. Zabuza gave out a hoarse laugh at his final act. It took a bit, but my sword's hidden ability finally came through. The Kubakirabacho is the blade that will never die. It rebuilds itself from the blood of its victims, and each broken piece retains this ability. Even those small fragments you managed to chip off that fell into your wound. You threw your life away. Ha, for a plan that might work. For a plan that wasted enough time for me to fatally injure you. You and Haku are the same. You both were just looking for a place to die. They both fell to their knees as their injuries caught up with them. Naruto's injury specifically was like the most painful form of cancer, as the metal cells just kept growing. While the little demon of the mist, done in by some brat, how pathetic. The shinobi on the bridge looked to the end of it to see the small portly man that was Gato standing there smugly with a small army of bandits behind him. Zabuza managed to muster enough strength to glare at Gato. Gato, what the hell are you doing here? Well, obviously I'm protecting my investments. You see, I have too much cemented into this country, and trusting you to handle this job was clearly a mistake, so I've decided that you are going to die here today on this bridge. Lucky me though, looks like the kid already beat me to it. The man boldly walked forward and stopped when he made it to the lone body of Haku. He looked at her face and rose an eyebrow. Oh? You are that masked kid Zabuza toted around, weren't you? If I had known you were a woman, and such a fine piece at, that I would have gotten some fun out of would have been the perfect payback for you breaking arm, you bitch. Gato had the gall to kick Haku's head. Zabuza could only glare, but Naruto was punched the bridge, cracking it with his knuckles, as he pushed himself up. Do not disrespect the dead. Naruto's eyes slitted finally again as his mind ignored his injuries and pain. ZRAIARZ in Naruto's eyes stated to fade from their blues to white, making his gaze all the more intimidating as some of the bandits stepped back. Naruto gained a grin that was soaked with both instability and a malicious sway a bit as he walked forward before stopping over his abuser. One of his eyes turned red, showing his mind wasn't exactly right at the moment. "These abuser, you using that? Guess you aren't anymore, rather you can't, huh? Mind if I take it off your hands?" "No. Why, thank you." Referring to his sword, Naruto grabbed the damaged weapon before Zabuza could even process a response. The chain around Naruto's neck cracked with a glowing light as Naruto's chakra flared about him with a hum. A hum similar to the staticky noise you would hear from standing under a giant pylon. "The bandits are fodder, so Gato, you are the only one I will keep alive." Fully bypassing the pain of his own injuries, Naruto vanished from sight as he shot forward. With each long stride, he left a cracked impression in the bridge from where his foot made contact. A second later, a man to Gato's right was bisected. It was as if time slowed down as they all turned to the man in slow motion to see Naruto having cleaved him in half with Zabuza's sword. Naruto bathed in blood made the metal in his body grow more, but his own chakra also caused that metal to break off him in a weird combination as he littered the bridge with iron. "However, even a pig like you will wish you was dead when you find out what joys I have in store for you." With the bloodbath that issued, the only way for the bandits to notice where he had been was the cluttering of metal scraps that fell under each bandit's mutilated and dismembered bodies. But by then it was too late, as the moment the metal fell, so did another body. In the backs of their minds, they could only gruesomely wonder, if Naruto did this alongside Zabuza, would his brutality be the same? Or worse? Thanks for listening. I do hope you enjoyed. If you want a next part of this video, like, subscribe, and comment down below, and turn on that bell notification. And also check out the other videos that I have created, and enjoy. See you in the next video. Peace.